hearing that hymn, and I was present, this is, I think, in the 70s, late 70s, but I will never forget it. I carry a notebook with me at all times, in which I put down things I hear that I don't want to forget. And I heard a prayer at a pastor's conference, and it was so good that I have it verbatim, and that's the first part, in my notebook because of what was said. Speaking of making a captive, Lord, reminds me of that prayer. The late D.E. King was pastor of the Monument Baptist Church in Chicago, Illinois, and he was asked very spontaneously to please come up to the pulpit and lead us in prayer. Dr. King was heavy set and had jowls like a bulldog. He got up there and he said, "Let us pray." And his first line was so arresting that I took out my notebook while he was praying. I thought, "Oh, this is going to be good." And I've got those lines. Listen to what he said. He said, "Father, we have come to turn ourselves in." That's when I got my book out. "We've been running from you, and we know you have a warrant out for our arrest. Arrest us,
yes,
and lock us up, yes, that we may be free." It is only when one is captive to the Lord that one is ultimately free.
Amen.
You're not free as long as you're running your life. You are only free when you are bound to Him. If you're able, would you please stand for the reading of God's Word, which today comes from the Gospel of our Lord as recorded by Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, I want to read three verses only, verses 16, 17, and 18. Matthew chapter 6, verses 16 through 18. After I've read, I'm going to hold my Bible high and say, "This is the word of the Lord." We have a high view of Scripture around here at Crossroads Church. I'm going to hold my Bible high and say, "This is the word of the Lord," and your response shall be,
"Thanks be to God."
Yes, yes. What a privilege to have the word of God. Hear the word of the Lord. Matthew 6, 16, from the New King James Version. "Moreover," says Jesus, "when you fast, do not be like the hypocrites with a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces so that they may appear to men to be fasting. Assuredly, I say, they have their reward. But you, when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, so that you do not appear to men to be fasting, but to your Father who is in the secret place. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Eternal God, we pray that as your word is proclaimed, we would get it, receiving it with gladness, and going forth from this place committed to being consecrated women and men who live out your word. Grant that it may be so, O Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus is most eager for his followers to live lives that are different, distinct from the lives lived by those who are not his. We'll call them the heathen, the hypocrite, the lost person, the non-believer. More than once, Jesus delivers this line, "Don't be like them." Did you see it? It's in verse 16. "When you fast, don't be like the hypocrites." Or working backwards, look at verse 7. "And when you pray, don't use vain repetitions like the heathen do." Or verse 5. "And when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites. They love to pray standing in the synagogues." Or verse 2. "Therefore, when you do a charitable deed, do not sound the trumpet before you like the hypocrites do." You hear it? Don't be like them. Don't be like them. Don't be like them. And when you do what you do, don't be like them. Don't take your cues from the hypocrites or the heathens or the culture that surrounds you. I want you to be different. That's the whole purpose of the Sermon on the Mount. This is a body of teaching about living a distinctive life. Picture the average listener on the mountainside. One thinks fasting is all good. Another person's thinking, this rabbi couldn't possibly have any complaint about fasting. Jesus seems to take on every behavior and turns it upside down and examines it, lest the people there who are hearing his teaching live too casually. I want to live intentionally. I don't want to be a Christian by accident. I want this to be what I've given myself to. I want us to do what we do as a choice, as if we have a purpose. There's some people who are content to be church people. They're moderately religious, and for them, that's enough. But I want us to be people who go for it. What was wrong with the fasting as it was done in Jesus' day? Why did he feel the need to talk about fasting? Glad you asked. I want to make some observations and do some practical teaching on fasting. First of all, the people in Jesus' day were fasting and looking like they were fasting. You know the type. They almost emaciate themselves so that you have to ask them, are you all right? Well, I don't want to brag, but I'm fasting. That's why I look a little hungry. I mean, they change their walk. They just try to look pitiful so that you'll ask them what's happening. Fasting is a discipline in which we deny ourselves physical nourishment in order to focus on spiritual nourishment. Let me say it again. This is a simple definition of fasting. It is a discipline in which we deny ourselves physical nourishment in order to focus on spiritual nourishment. Just go a few pages to the right and join me in John chapter 6. I'm going to take you to more passages than usual today because I want you to connect some dots in your own understanding of this discipline. John chapter 6. I begin the reading at verse 27 and then I'm going to skip down to 32. John 6:27. This is Jesus speaking. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set a seal on him. So he's saying, don't let your focus be physical food. You see it there? But rather, spiritual nourishment. Now skip down to verse 32 of John 6. Then Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. Now there is spiritual sustenance. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Then they said to him, Lord, give us this bread always. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. Do you see it? Jesus raises the issue of both physical food and spiritual food. And he's not saying you should never eat. He's saying if you're going to focus on any kind of nourishment, don't be physically food-oriented. I want you to think on the importance of the bread that comes down from heaven. And then he says, and I am that bread. Do you know any people? I have a couple of friends like this. For all of their landmarks are restaurants. Their conversation is all about food. Do you know any people who are food focused? I do. I know some people who are guilty of one great vice, overactive fork. And they love to talk about their foodies to the extreme. They love to talk about food. The only problem with that is you don't think about the other ways in which we are nourished. It's not all about food. I enjoy a good meal, but what Jesus is saying is don't labor, don't spend all your energy on physical food and miss the point that you are nourished in other kinds of ways. Jesus does not condemn or discourage fasting. He does, however, remind his listeners that if they're going to focus on spiritual nourishment, they should never do it in a way that makes people ask questions. Are you fasting? Are you sick? Don't look hungry when you are fasting. This is a good principle here. What exactly is fasting? It's one of the spiritual disciplines. The spiritual discipline is a habit or an action that results in deepening faith and intimacy with God. And when we speak of spiritual disciplines, in the literature of spiritual disciplines, there are usually two categories. And there'll be different words used for them, but essentially, the categories are disciplines of action and disciplines of abstinence. That is, there are things we do to develop our intimacy with God, and there are actions from which we refrain in order to grow with our God. There are actions and there are abstinences. For instance, here are some spiritual disciplines that are action disciplines. Study, worship, prayer, fellowship, confession. Those are all spiritual disciplines. Submission is a spiritual discipline. There are then disciplines of abstinence, that is, things from which we refrain. Solitude is one of them. That's a spiritual discipline where one goes off by oneself and abstains from being with other people. Frugality is a spiritual discipline. You know, the Catholic priests take a vow of poverty. Frugality and not spending much money is a spiritual discipline, and we are abstaining at that point from materialism. Chastity is a spiritual discipline, and it is abstaining from sexual activity, especially when one is unmarried. Secrecy is a spiritual discipline, and that is holding matters to oneself and giving up the joy of sharing it with other people. Sacrifice is a spiritual discipline, and fasting is a spiritual discipline. When we fast, during the time we would be eating the meal, we read the scriptures, we speak to God, we listen to God, we spend time in silence. That's what one does during a fast and during the time you would eat a meal. So I'm asking you to fast every Thursday of this month of consecration. Some of you might continue that discipline right through the year, fasting once or twice a month. It's a very good discipline. During the time I would be eating breakfast, I will spend time in the scriptures, spend time in silence, maybe a combination of both. During the time I would be eating lunch, I will take that lunch hour, that lunch 45 minutes, and I will spend time with the Lord, focusing on spiritual nourishment in the place of, during the same time period in which I would be nourishing myself physically. In our text, notice Jesus does not discourage fasting. On the contrary, he taught on it, but he made sure the people understood what their motivation should be. So look at verse 16 of our text, Matthew 6. When you fast, do not be like the hypocrites with a sad countenance. They disfigure their faces that they may appear to people to be fasting. And Jesus says, if that's all you want to be seen, then the moment you go out looking emaciated and dirty, then you've gotten your reward. You wanted to be seen, you've been seen, have a nice day. That's it. You had your reward. Then Jesus says, when you fast, then he teaches them about their demeanor. Let me talk about fasting very practically. In the Bible, there are examples of, and these are in my notes, which are available to you if you just email me and put in the subject line, sermon notes. I will send this message, these notes to you before the end of this day, Lord willing. But the Bible has descriptions of one-day fasts. You'll find that in Judges chapter 20, verse 26. A three-day fast in the book of Esther 4:16, a seven-day fast in 1 Samuel 31:13, and Jesus participated in a 40-day fast. In fact, I do want you to see that one. You're already in Matthew's gospel. Just turn to the left if you're in the print Bible to chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights afterward, he was hungry. That's all I want you to see. 40 days and 40 nights. And we don't know exactly what kind of fast it was, because there are a number of kinds of fasts. And I want you to consider these as we go into this month of consecration. There is an absolute fast in which a person takes neither food nor drink. That's very difficult and for most people would be medically dangerous. But it is at least a kind of fast. I want you to be reminded of that in Acts chapter 9 is a description of Paul. Acts 9:8. Then Saul arose from the ground, and when his eyes were open, he saw no one. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight and neither ate nor drank. Now that's an absolute fast where one has no liquid, no solid food. And again, for most people, that would be medically dangerous and not advised. But if you are led of the Lord to have an absolute fast because there's something you're really seeking from the Lord, then that is a fast to consider. There is a fast in which one eats regular food, but no, in the words of the Bible, no pleasant food. That is probably, it refers to no sweets, no desserts. So Daniel, for instance, in the book of Daniel chapter 10, I'll turn to it and I'll read it to you in the interest of time. Don't flip there, but let me take you to Daniel chapter 10, first three verses. In the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a message was revealed to Daniel, whose name was called Belshazzar. The message was true, but the appointed time was long, and he understood the message and had understanding of the vision. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. I ate no pleasant food. No meat or wine came into my mouth, nor did I anoint myself at all, till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. So perhaps he ate just the basics, no pleasant food. Maybe he had only vegetables, only salad. He had no meat, no wine. It was a very simple fast. Maybe you'll have that kind of fast. You say, Pastor, I'm not ready to have no food at all, but I will have just a small salad. I will not eat my standard lunch, and I will focus on the Lord. You have to find a level at which you can begin this discipline. There is a vegetables and water fast. That's also in the book of Daniel, chapter 1. And you might recall that story where Daniel was challenged or invited to eat the king's meat. And he said, no, I'm not eating the king's food. Daniel's very shrewd. He knows he can't eat the king's food and then stand up and challenge the king. So he says, no, I'll pass. I don't want your food. Keep your food. I'm about to challenge you. I'd rather not eat your food. So Daniel goes on a fast and he says, listen, could I please just have my own diet? I'll arrange the diet. I'll determine the diet. I don't want the king's food. And there's a delightful story in the first chapter of Daniel, in which Daniel determines his own diet, and at the end of that time, he goes before the king, and he's healthier than the people who weren't on the Daniel diet. The Daniel fast, it is called. It is vegetables and water. And you read a description of that in Daniel chapter 1. And there are variations on all these examples. You can fast with a liquid-only fast. You say, I'm not going to eat, but I am going to continue to take in nourishment. Someone asked, can you drink supplementary dietary drinks, slim fast, and those other kinds of protein shakes during the fast? Yes, that's something, again, you have to work out between you and the Lord. But I certainly want you to experience what it means to deny yourself. That you can't have full meals and have only one can of Coke instead of two and say, I'm fasting. That's not a serious fast. In some way, you deny yourself. You abstain from the normal level of eating of physical food in favor of the spiritual food. I'm not sure a fruit smoothie and a juiced veggie drink would qualify as you're really denying yourself if you're going to have six smoothies and four veggie drinks and you're going to get your Vitamix or your Ninja and say, well, I'm not really having a meal. Yeah, you're having liquid, but it's a whole head of broccoli, just simply pureed. So you're not really giving up anything. But again, you work that out. In these examples in the scriptures, it is very clear that people want to focus on God and therefore must, in the words of the old saints, push the plate aside. The old saints used to say, I'm turning down my plate for the next 3 days. By that they mean I'm not going to eat. Perhaps you'll fast for one day a week for this month and then evaluate. What were you sensing? What did you experience? That's what I'm asking you to do for a month. Skip meals each Thursday and come together for a time of prayer at 7 in the evening. Break your fast before the evening prayer time and see what God will do through, for many of you, this first time in this spiritual discipline. Some of you are under medical care and you must eat at certain times of the day. Please respect that. Please work with your doctor and do what is appropriate and what is wise in the name of ministry, in the name of this discipline. Don't ignore your doctor's directives or don't ignore common sense as you fast. And again, if you've never fasted, you don't go immediately into a 10-day fast. You do baby steps and see what God will do. Some will skip breakfast only and they'll eat lunch and dinner. Some will fast breakfast and lunch and then break the fast at supper time. You work that out. I want you to begin to see what God does when we deny ourselves. Jesus is teaching that we should wash our faces when we fast, anoint ourselves, look like you're normal. Stop trying to look desperate and hungry, but rather do your fasting as a secret discipline. You might share it with others. It might be a blessing to others to know that you're engaged in this discipline, but be discerning. This is not something about which you brag, but you might tell a person. For instance, if a person invites you to lunch on Thursday, you might say, I can't lunch with you this Thursday, and I can't lunch, in fact, any of the Thursdays of January. I'm in a discipline of not eating lunches on Thursdays of this month, but I'd be happy to go to lunch with you the first week of February. Would that be all right? Or you could change there's nothing magical about the day. You can say, yes, I accept your invitation, and you fast on Tuesday. Yes, nothing's going to happen if you don't do this on the Thursday. Most of us want to do this on Thursday, but you find your place. It is not my role to tell you what to do and how to do it. I want to give you some teaching, some places you can begin. Jesus makes it very clear that there's a way of fasting in which you wind up playing to a human audience. First of all, they were fasting and looking like they were fasting, which is a no-no. Then they were fasting and playing to the wrong audience. By that I mean that they were most eager to be seen by other humans And our goal in fasting is always to get closer to God, and through the fast, remind ourselves that God is our sustenance and God is our audience. We play to an audience of one. We do not fast ever in order to impress other people. We play to the audience of one. But we can never impress God, so we do not fast in order to impress God. But we do what we do before Him. It's impossible for any human being to impress God, let's face it, or to score points by what you do. God, did you know I'm fasting? Did you see? God, did you see my tithe that I gave? God, did you see the charitable acts that I did? Did you see the alms? No. We do what we do as part of our journey toward complete surrender to and obedience to Jesus Christ. He is our focus when we fast. Oh, bread of heaven, you might pray, fill me during this lunch hour with a renewed sense of your calling upon my life. You are the bread of life, and you sustain me more than does bread and meat. So, oh, bread of heaven, as I spend these minutes in your presence, would you please remind me of what you want for me and what you want from me? That would be what you might do during your mealtime. You might talk to God. You might remind yourself that He is your sustenance. And since we are playing to God, and to God alone, and since we ultimately put ourselves before an audience of one, let us each determine the best format and style of fast and make this all about God. As your pastor, I'm asking you to engage in this discipline with me, with us. As a body, let us explore what God does through fasting. Let me give you some results of fasting, and then I'm going to wrap this up and move to the table, which reminds us that Jesus is our bread, our sustenance. Results of fasting. There's the cleansing and renewing of the body. Just as a doctor might ask you to fast before a medical procedure so that the body systems will not interfere with the doctor's work, when we fast, we make our bodies lighter. There are spiritual benefits to fasting, and there are physical benefits to fasting. It cleanses the body, gives the body a chance to flush and be renewed. I was trying to find some information on the physical benefits of fasting, and on the website questdiagnostics.com, a person asked the question, why do I have to fast before certain lab tests? And the answer on the website was, nutrients and ingredients in the food and beverages you consume are absorbed into your bloodstream and could impact factors measured by certain tests. Fasting improves the accuracy of those tests. That you don't have stuff in your bloodstream that might conflict with the test. So you need to cleanse the system. Fasting does that. In fact, I read of a study, this is really interesting to me, study at the University of Southern California in 2014, the study was published, says that fasting for as few as 3 days could regenerate the entire immune system. That when you fast, it flips a regenerative switch which prompts the stem cells to create brand new white blood cells. You can actually give a boost to your immune system by cleansing the body. Stop putting all that junk in there, maybe for a day, a month. You give the body a rest. Stop stuffing your pie hole. Did I say that out loud? Yes. So fasting has physical benefits. Fasting can intensify the prayer life. Fasting can intensify the prayer life. You know, if you're not careful, I've been a person of prayer for over 50 years now. I became a serious follower of Jesus when I was 12. And I began developing a prayer life. But if you're not careful, I know you will find this to be true. You have found this to be true. You'll agree with me. If you're not careful, prayers can become very mechanical. Where you're not even thinking about talking to God, you're just thinking about getting through the prayer. Let me say the Our Father. Let me get it done. If you're not careful, you'll wind up praying without a thought. Fasting changes the prayer life and makes it something else. Fasting allows you to dig in your heels in prayer. There's a wonderful story. In fact, I want you to see this story. You're already in Matthew if you're with me in our text. But turn to chapter 17. I want to show you a story that you need to know. Chapter 17 of Matthew. I'll begin the reading at 21. Well, let me back up. Let me start at 14. And when they come to the multitude, a man came to Jesus, kneeling down to him and saying, "Lord, have mercy on my son. He is an epileptic and suffers severely, for he often falls into fire and often into the water. So I brought him to your disciples, but they could not cure him." And Jesus answered and said, "Oh, faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me." I wish I could say this like Jesus must have said it. "Bring the boy here. Bring him to me. Bring him to me." And Jesus rebuked the demon, and he came out of it. And the child was cured from that very hour. Now listen to this. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, "Why could we not cast it out?" He was this demon-possessed boy. The father of the boy brought the boy to the disciple, figuring, "You guys are close to Jesus. You have the power and the authority of Jesus. Cure my boy." They couldn't do it. And they wanted to know why. "Why were we not effective?" they say to Jesus. Listen to what Jesus says. This is so good. "Because of your unbelief. For assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, 'Move from here to there,' and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. However," this is Matthew 17:21. You have underlined this in your Bible. "However, this kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting." There is a level of ministry, a level of spiritual engagement that is not available to you if you only pray mechanically. There are places we won't be able to go if we're just faking. Jesus says the reason you weren't effective is because this is some graduate level spiritual stuff here. And you guys are running around with your GED. You can't take on these kind of demons if you're not serious. There is a level of engagement. There's a level of spiritual activity that you will never know except that you engage yourself in prayer and fasting. Notice that Jesus doesn't say you didn't pray hard enough. No, this kind of demon can only be exorcised by a person who is both praying and fasting. Wow. It's in the book. God's word tells us clearly that fasting will intensify the ordinary prayer life. You want your prayer life to be on steroids? Couple it with fasting, with denying oneself that one might engage our God who is our true bread. Let me wrap this up. practical matters. If you're under a doctor's care, tell your doctor that you want to fast. Make sure there are no reasons you should not. Start slowly if you've never fasted. And during the time you would have your meal, make that a time of engaging the Word of God, a time of prayer and reflection and meditation, both speaking to God and listening for His voice. If you will be quiet, God will drop thoughts into your mind. That is the Lord speaking to you. You may not hear an audible voice, probably not. But as you simply open your heart and mind to God and just simply listen, you'll be surprised. The Lord will speak to you in very clear ways. He'll drop thoughts into your mind that you did not have before. That is the Lord speaking. Consider writing and documenting the fasting experience with brief diary or journal entries. How does it feel? What kinds of thoughts are coming to you? What did you experience spiritually? So I'm asking you to fast every Thursday of this month. Break your fast at approximately 6 p.m. and then come here to join us for an hour of prayer and celebration as to what God is up to. And let's see what God will do. I'm expecting God to speak to us and transform us through our commitment to ministry and this discipline of fasting. As you leave today, there is a resource page that has Bible verses about fasting, some of the verses which I read and other verses, has internet resources, articles that you might read on the web that will help you. I close with a quote from James I. Packer, wonderful Bible scholar. He makes a good point about fasting in general in his book, Your Father Loves You. And with this I close. Packer speaking. We tend to think of fasting as going without food. But we can fast from anything. If you love music and decide to miss a concert in order to spend time with God, that is fasting. It is helpful to think of the parallel of human friendship. When friends need to be together, they will cancel all other activities in order to make that possible. There's nothing magical about fasting, continues Packer. It's just one way of telling God that your priority at the moment is to be alone with Him, sorting out whatever is necessary, and you've canceled the meal, the party, the concert, or whatever else you plan to do in order to fulfill that priority. God, I'm dropping everything, I'm canceling everything to be with you. Let's see what God does. Join me on the fast track. Let us pray. O God, who art our sustenance, our very bread, we thank you for Jesus, for his example, and for his teaching. And pray that as we fast, many of us, we would do so with proper motives. We want to know you more intimately, O God. We want to walk with you and have a vibrant, authentic, spiritual life. Please deliver us from faking it. Deliver us from mere religiosity. Deliver us from simply being church members. Fill us, we pray, with a hunger and a thirst that won't quit. We pray especially for those who will be fasting for the first time. Pray, O Lord, that you would speak to them, speak to us, as we remind ourselves that in you we live and move and have our being. I pray for those who have crowded their lives with everything but you. For those who are more committed to their pleasures than to you, O God. Those who love their cars more than they love you.
for those who are focused on money more than they're focused on you, the bread of life, for those who are focused on physical food, for those who are addicted to food, to substances. Pray that you would deliver them, and through this time of fasting, show them thyself in manifest ways. We pray that you would use us, the captives of your own purposes, to deliver and free other captives. We pray that you'd make us captives who proclaim Jesus Christ, the liberator. May we proclaim you in such clear ways that scores, hundreds, thousands of people will come to know you as a result of our ministry. Help us. We would be disciplined followers and can only be so with thy help. Holy Spirit of God, we submit ourselves afresh to you. We quench you not. We ignore you not. As you speak to us daily, reminding us of what Jesus said, may we give ourselves afresh anew to being spirit-led people. Father, we've come to turn ourselves in. We've been running from you, and we know you have a warrant out for our arrest. Arrest us and lock us up that we may be free. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, we pray. And everybody sang amen. Everybody sang
amen.
Everybody sang
amen.
Service, please come.
Amen.
Everybody sing amen.
Amen.
God is speaking. From this place
rejoicing that Christ has come for us. Christ has been born. Christ has died. Christ has been buried. Christ is risen. Now go from this place, and may he give you light for darkness and joy for sadness. And may you experience his holding you up all week long. Let us rejoice in him. Beloved, go. And may the peace of Jesus ever rest upon you and in you. May the world in which you live be different because you're in it. Amen.
Amen.